Welcome to church, everyone, on this Thanksgiving morning. I just want to make a quick, maybe it's not a necessary announcement, but I guess it is. October is Pastor Appreciation Month, and Pastor Andrew noticed this morning that I had a gift, but I don't know if he realized it was for him. Thank you so much for all the work you do in this church. It's kind of nice to know that all over the world that we're all appreciating pastors, I think, and as a congregation, would thank you so much for the work you do, the visits you do, the wonderful sermons that you preach, and just spreading God's word. So thank you so much for all the work you do, Pastor Andrew.
I did wonder why Brad had had a gift in his hand, and I guess I should have wondered a little more. But thank you for the kind token of appreciation. I will open it later, and I guess next week I'll have to inform you what it was. Congregation, welcome to church on a Thanksgiving Monday. I led a service yesterday in Wyoming CRC, and it was a pleasure to be there, but it's good to be back in our midst as well. On a day that we normally don't gather for worship. Normally we're in the fields, we're in the barns, we're doing our regular thing, we're at school and all those other activities. But on this weekend, on this day, I had somebody ask me, a young fellow at the back of church just talked to me and said, "Why do we have church on Monday?" And that's a good question. Because normally when someone gives you something, I said, we give thanks to that person. If somebody gives you a gift, we give thanks. And so today, that's part of why we're here, to give thanks. If you maybe noticed on the benches or the seats as you came in, there's also a nice little piece of paper. I didn't grab one up front here with me, but Doug, you want to hold it up nice and high? There you go. You hopefully have that tag. There'll be a point actually in the service where we're taking a moment to write things down on that. So that'll be later on in the service. But just to give thanks for the wonderful gifts that we've been given. And normally what we would do in a time like this is maybe we would cut them out into leaves and then we'd put them on a tree. But we actually have, if you look just down the hall, I don't know, I think the door's left open here. There's a bulletin board right at the end of the hall. There's push pins there. And so as we leave the service today, you can take those things that you have filled out, and then there's pushpins, and I invite you to just place them there, just as a reminder of the things that we are thankful for. So don't fill it out now. Like I said, there'll be a time in the service to do that. Our service today will be a little bit different from our regular services. It'll have kind of four parts. Each part will have some scripture reading, kind of a short reflection or meditation, and then also something, an activity or a prayer or other parts that we'll do, including filling out those things. So that's what the service will look like this morning. And I pray that God is praised and his people blessed also as we celebrate God's goodness to us in what has been a very different year for all of us. Now, congregation, at this time I'm going to invite you to stand for the call to worship. The call to worship is on the screen, and I invite you to participate and look at your parts there. It's Psalm 100. This is actually the psalm that I preached on yesterday at Wyoming CRC, and this is what it says. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Come before him with joyful songs. It is he who made us, and we are his. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Indeed, brothers and sisters, that's Psalm 100. And we'll actually close out our service by singing that psalm, because it's a beautiful psalm that reminds us of what we are called to do, to praise the Lord. Now, congregation, as we've gathered in this place on this Monday morning, receive the greeting of our God. May grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God the Father, from Jesus Christ, the risen Lord, his Son, through the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. And all God's people say, Amen. Now, congregation, our service this morning is kind of structured around the following song, For the Beauty of the Earth. And we're going to sing this song as it leads into this service. So for the beauty of the earth, let's remain standing as we sing. So that first piece that we're looking at this morning is for the beauty of the earth. And I'm going to reflect on Psalm 33. This is what the psalmist writes. Sing joyfully to the Lord, you righteous. It is fitting for the upright to praise him. Praise the Lord with a harp. Make music to him on the 10-stringed lyre. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully and shout for joy. For the word of the Lord is right and true. He is faithful in all he does. The Lord loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of his unfailing love. By the word of the Lord were the heavens made, their starry host by the breath of his mouth. He gathers the waters of the sea into jars. He puts the deep into storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the people of the world revere him. For he spoke, and it came to be. He commanded, and it stood firm. The Lord foils the plans of the nations. He thwarts the purposes of the peoples. But the plans of the Lord stand firm forever, the purposes of his heart through all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people he chose for his inheritance. From heaven the Lord looks down and sees all mankind. From his dwelling place he watches all who live on the earth. He who forms the hearts of all, who considers everything they do. No king is saved by the size of his army. No warrior escapes by his great strength. A horse is a vain hope for deliverance. As we put our hope in you. Now, congregation, as I read this psalm, maybe certain images were brought to mind. This psalm tells us how God is almighty, majestic, how he's all-powerful, how he's also the God of everyday gifts of beauty, of gifts of grace. Our God has made the whole earth. and everything in it, including each and every one of us. God is attentive to every detail and to each person. He knows us and sees us. In fact, the Heidelberg Catechism in question and answer 26 says, God provides for us everything we need for body and soul. And that is why we are here, to praise Him. Let me lead us in a prayer. Lord God, as we have just sung, Lord, we praise You for the beauty of the earth. Lord, for the glory of the skies, for the love which from our birth over and around us lies. Christ our Lord, to You today we raise our hymn of grateful praise. Lord, for rain and for sunshine, for the harvest, for the beans that are almost off or mostly off, for flowers, for mountains and birds and leaves, Lord, for paychecks and clothing, for shelter and tasty food. Lord, we thank You for all Your gifts and for the beauty of the earth that's around us. Amen. At this time, our reflection is going to be on the slideshow that Marianne has put together for us. So I invite you to turn to the screen as we watch together. Indeed, as that slideshow reminded us of, many, many things to give thanks for also in the beauty of the earth. At this time, we're going to sing a song of response, Give Thanks. Why don't we stand as we sing this song? Seated. This next section, congregation, is titled Savoring the Moments, the Wonder of Each Hour. And I'm reading now from the Gospel of Luke chapter 2. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger." Suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what they had been told about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But this is what I want us to reflect on. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Congregation, that text that I just read from Luke is a text that we often read in the Christmas season. But I brought to attention there verse 19. Mary treasured up all these things. She pondered them. She savored them. Have any of us ever had an experience that was so profound, so meaningful, so moving that you just wished you could record it and keep it for all time? Have someone like Marianne take a picture of it so that you could always keep it with you? But a picture, well, it's worth 1,000 words, doesn't capture the scent, the sound, the smell, the feeling, the thoughts and emotions. The text we just read from Luke chapter 2 tells us that Mary had many profound experiences. The angel's first visit, the message that she was carrying the Son of the Most High, the birth of this precious child. And then in this text, a crew of shepherds that showed up. But the text tells us she didn't just think about these things. She savored them. When you have Thanksgiving dinner, maybe you have a very special dessert, a dessert that you just love to eat. You twist it and turn it on your tongue, and it stays with you. You savor it. Mary pondered these things in her heart so as to be formed by them. A profound sense of humility before God, and also a profound sense of gratitude and thankfulness. Some of the wisest, some of the most humble, and some of the most grateful people I know are the ones who go through life with a sense of wonder and expectation, seeing what God will do next, looking and finding evidence of God's work in the world around them. Someone today came into church quoting one of the Psalms, "I will enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise." Each day looking to be blessed and see God at work in the world. Savor those moments, brothers and sisters. Ponder them in your heart. Let me lead us in a prayer. Lord God, we thank you for the wonder of each hour, of the day and of the night. Lord Christ our Lord, to you we raise this our hymn of grateful praise. Lord, we thank you for the experiences that you've given us over the past year. Some have brought us great joy. Some, Lord, have opened our eyes to a new dimension of life. Some things, Lord, especially this year, have been tough. But through them, through the good and the bad, Lord, may we be able to see that we have experienced your care. Lord, may we have learned and may we have grown. Lord God, some of the moments that we've experienced have quietly nurtured us. Lord, they've been like daily bread to us. Lord God, we thank you for the moments this past year. Lord, for being present with us. Lord, for speaking and providing for us each and every day. Lord, to you we lift our hymn of grateful praise. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, we're going to stand and sing a wonderful hymn, 10,000 Reasons, just starting to count some of the many reasons that we have to praise God. Let's stand as we sing that wonderful hymn. seated. Congregation, savoring loved ones, the joy of human love. Reading from Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15 to 23. Paul writes this to the church in Ephesus. For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and your love for all the saints, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray also that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and his incomparably great power for us, for those who believe. That power is like the working of his mighty strength, which he exerts in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every title that can be given, not only in the present age, but also in the age to come. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be the head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. Congregation, I don't know how familiar you are with Paul's epistles. I remember studying them in seminary and my professor teaching us that Paul's letters all followed, or almost all followed, a particular pattern. One of the things that Paul does near the beginning of every single letter is express praise and thanksgiving. Praise and thanksgiving for those to whom he is writing, opening his letter with praise and thanks. That's a good habit for us to follow in life as well. When we begin our meals, when we begin our meetings, when we begin our weeks on Sunday, often here in this place, worship and giving thanks makes sense. All that we have, all that is around us, all the good gifts begin with God, the creator and sustainer of all things. Paul, here in this letter, he takes note of the Ephesians' faith, and he thanks God for them and for what he sees also happening in their hearts and lives. This Thanksgiving Day, I invite you too to notice God's gifts in the people around us and to thank God for those people. In just a moment, I'm going to lead us in a congregational prayer, a prayer of thanksgiving. However, as I pray this prayer, I'm going to give a time of silence, an extended time for you to name and to thank the Lord for the people that he has placed in your life for whom you are thankful and grateful for. So in that time of silence, I invite you to fill it quietly with the people in your life for whom you give praise. Let me lead us now as we pray. Lord God, for the joy of human love, for brother, sister, parent, child, Lord, friends on earth and friends above, for all gentle thoughts and mild, Christ our Lord, to you we raise this our hymn of grateful praise. Lord God, we thank you for the people in our lives through whom you have blessed us, and we name them before you now. Lord God, we thank you for the people that you have placed in our lives, for each one mentioned silently also before you now. Lord, we thank you for your work in their lives. Lord, and the blessing that those people that we have named have been to us. Lord, we thank you for our church. We thank you for this communion of the saints. Lord, joining in the video link, Lord, and we praise you for that technology and the joy that that also brings and the blessing that is. Lord, we pray, even as there are difficult times that we sometimes go through, that you help us, Lord, to see in each other your provision and your love and your gift to us. Lord, for the joy of human love, brother, sister, parent, child, friend on earth and friend above, for all gentle thoughts and mild, Lord, to you we raise our hymn of grateful praise. Amen. At this time, we're going to stand and sing our next song of thankfulness. Now thank we all our God. Let's indeed stand as we sing this song. Be seated. Our final reflection and text, savoring Christ, the best gift divine. From 2 Corinthians chapter 9, I'm going to read from verse 6 to 15. Paul writes this to the church in Corinth. Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion. For God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. As it is written, he has scattered abroad his gifts to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be made rich in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. This service you perform is not only supplying the needs of God's people, but is also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God. Because of the service by which you have provided yourselves, men will praise God for the obedience that accompanies your confession of the gospel of Christ, and for your generosity in sharing with them and with everything else. And in their prayers for you, their hearts will go out to you because of the surpassing grace God has given you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. You know, brothers and sisters, everything, Paul says, flows out of one simple fact: the great generosity of our God. Just as we love because God loved us first, so we give because God first gave to us. And God gave us the most wonderful and indescribable gift, his Son, who suffered and died for us so that we might have eternal life. Let me lead us in a prayer. Lord God, as we've sung, for yourself, best give to find, to the world so freely given, agent of God's grand design, peace on earth and joy in heaven. Lord Jesus Christ, to you we raise, today and this year, our hymn of grateful praise. Lord God, we thank you for the blessings in the world around us, for the richness of moments and experiences. Lord, we thank you for the blessing of people that you have placed in our lives. All indeed, Lord God, wonderful gifts. But Lord God, we reserve our most heartfelt gratitude for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord God, our words cannot really fully express our thanks. But Lord, accept our love and our gratitude. Lord Jesus, we love you. Amen. Now, congregation, at this time, I'm going to invite you to look on the pew next to you or on the seats next to you and to take that little card that you have. I'm going to take you, and I invite you at this time, hopefully there's also a pen there, to take some time to reflect, if you're sitting in a pew with others, to reflect together with them on what you are truly thankful for. If you need to fill up the front and end up going onto the back, that is all right as well. But do take the time to fill it out together. Pat and Ingrid are going to be accompanying this and playing a song, Creation Sings the Father's Song. Again, take the time that you need to fill out the card, but then you are more than welcome to also join in the singing as you wish. So let's remain seated as you fill out the cards at this time. blessing of our God. Brothers and sisters, at the end of the service, we're going to sing Psalm 100, put to music, "Praise God from whom all blessings flow," because indeed, He is the one we praise. And brothers and sisters, the God that we love, the God that we serve, also blesses us as we go from this place, this Thanksgiving Monday. Brothers and sisters, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord turn His face toward you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn His face toward you and give you His peace. And all God's people say, Amen. Today, if you could, take these little pieces of paper. I invite you to take them. And again, as I said, at the end of the hallway there, there are push pins. Just take the one pin that you'll use, please, and just pin them there as a reminder, too, of the many things for which we are thankful. May the Lord bless you as we also serve Him this day.